Hey guys, hopefully you are doing well. Come over to thisisvillagechurch.com. It's a whole website, explains everything that we're about as a church, all of our campuses, all of our sites. We don't want you to just watch these sermons. I mean, we're glad we are. We want you to actually get engaged in our church, in the life of our church. thisisvillagechurch.com/groups is how you actually start attending a group from anywhere. We try to collect anybody, Zoom, whatever we do, cities all over the world. Oh, there's 8 of you in Wisconsin. Meet in a group. This is awesome. That would be great. If you want to give, which would be so appreciated because it obviously costs money to do all of this, thisisvillagechurch.com/give. We can resource technology and staffing and everything so we can love and serve you well and continue the mission that Jesus is doing amazing things across the country of Canada, but also all around the world. We're hearing your stories. So let us know your stories. Email us your stories to hello@thisisvillagechurch.com. We would love to hear how God is blessing you through the ministry of Village Church. Hopefully you have a great week and you enjoy the teaching. Hey, Village Church, so good to have you. We are in the Gospel of John, and this is the last sermon in a conversation that has ended up being 3 or 4 sermons on a conversation that Jesus has with a woman, Samaritan woman at the well. It's a pretty famous story. And today it lands on this huge point that I wanted to spend, maybe it might be a shorter time, I'm not really sure, of one big idea. Just like last week, we honed in on this idea of mission. This week, we hone in on this really big idea that Jesus brings up in this text. So hopefully you guys have had a great week. John chapter 4 is where we are. And she has gone back to Samaria, this woman. She's met Jesus, and now she's gone and told her friends about him and said, "You got to meet this guy. He changed my life. He knew everything about me." And we ask the question, are you doing that? Are you excited enough that Jesus saved you that you're telling other people? And hopefully that's true about your life. And now we see this cool thing happen, which is super important for the questions we're asking in the world that we live in. Verse 30, they went out of the town and were coming to him, meaning coming back to Jesus and listening to him and wanting to know more about him. And then it says this, meanwhile, the disciples were urging him saying, "Rabbi, eat." But he said, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So they're coming to him just like he's preaching a lot. He's doing all this stuff and they're worried about him, making sure he's got energy. Now, it's nice to have people like that around you, right? Like I remember when I used to preach a lot and have to do 5 or 6 services and drive around town, nobody cared about me, all right? It was just, you know what? I'm just kidding. No, the other leaders, the pastors, the elders, everybody was like, "Mark, you look white as a sheet half the time. Why do you look like you're always ready to fall over?" Which is actually one of the reasons that we switched to me preaching one service and then all the other services were video, because we're like, you know what? It's probably not a good trade that Mark dies, but then we tried to get him in front of as many people as possible live. We realized, man, that's not good. So let's make sure he's taken care of. And so this is what these disciples are doing. They're going, "Eat. We want you to make sure that you don't fall over." And Jesus says this, because they say, "Has anyone brought him food to eat?" Because he's playing with them metaphorically. "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work." And so first off, we have this question of Jesus is saying, "I have food that you don't know about. I have a kind of, listen, satisfaction that the physical things of this world can't meet." Boom, preach it. Like if we were live right now, I would expect it, come on. Like, amen. I have a satisfaction in God that nothing in this world can meet. Let's go, say it to your screen. Yo, amen. This is the question of life. My oldest daughter yesterday, jumped on Skip the Dishes and ordered Dairy Queen. She loves Dairy Queen, like the blizzards, right? So she's got a blizzard that she orders. So she orders it and she waits half an hour and then she looks at the app. She realizes it's already been dropped off. The problem is it was dropped off at the last house we ordered Skip the Dishes to, which was our friend's house, which is 10 minutes away. And now her ice cream's sitting over there. So of course, mom, and they go over, they drive over there, they get there, and there's all these blizzards lined up at these people's houses. And of course, that mom didn't know what was going on. She thought maybe the kids had ordered these. So one kid has taken Sienna's blizzard and gone off and eaten the whole thing because he didn't know what was going on. He thought his parents ordered us a blizzard, just a comedy of disastrous errors. And for the rest of the night, this girl looked like her puppy had died, all right? It was like, but my blizzard. You know, it's like, man, what we eat matters, right? Like, we get upset if we can't eat what we want to eat. My buddy, I felt bad the other day. I was sitting with my buddy, and we're sitting out at this little patio, and I ordered like chicken, like deep fried chicken fingers and French fries and a little, and I said, what are you going to order? And he's like, oh, nothing, I'm fasting. I'm like, right. So I'm like, he's being all, and when someone says they're fasting and you've ordered food, you know, they got that look in their eye, like I'm better than you. What a jerk. That this guy just looked at me like he's better than me. And I'm sitting there dipping my deep fried chicken finger. And blah, oh, you're fasting, right? Food and spirituality, all of this is connected. And Jesus is saying, man, I got a kind of food. He's looking at the world. And the question is, can your life look at the world and go, man, I have a kind of satisfaction in God that nothing in this world can actually meet. Is God all satisfying to you? As we talked about a couple of weeks ago, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. Or is the only thing that you get like stimulation from is looking cool online. And so you bust everyone's chops and you point fingers and you're judgmental all the time. If that's how you get your kicks in life, God is not all satisfying to you. That's how this filters down to normal life. If all you get stimulation from is buying new stuff on Amazon or going to the store and buying a new sparkly dress for yourself or cool shoes for yourself, or then God is not all satisfying to you. If you overwork because you want to try to get a better spot in the company, and so you're constantly doing that because something about you just needs to get ahead of everybody else because your reputation, and you walk around and tell everybody how good, then God is not all satisfying to you. If you trade out spouses because you think what this is going to do that, then God is not all satisfying to you. If you trade out sexual partners like their cheap suits and bag, then God is not all satisfying to you. You get a rhythm here. There's the practical filtering down. You hit the bottle, you entertain too much, you go to entertainment too much to give you the stimulation. You shop, you work, all of this is pointing to a soul that's got something else to eat than to be fully satisfied in God and God alone. That if He's all you had, the world would look and go, there's a kind of contentment in this person's life that I want to know about. This is all the question of, am I satisfied? And some of you aren't because you haven't tried God. See, Jesus isn't just the answer to your sinfulness. Right? We tend to pitch Jesus as you're sinful and Jesus is the answer, and we're all, everyone's sleeping. Jesus Christ is the answer also to your restlessness, to you going after the thing to make you feel better in the moment. Jesus is also the all-satisfying answer to that, not just to save you from your sin, to save you from your restlessness, to save you from going around trying. He's the answer, but we're looking to the wrong things. And so Jesus looks to the disciples and He says, I have a food to eat that you don't even know about. So the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought Him food? Something to eat. Jesus said, my food is to do the will of Him who sent me. Again, this sent one. Remember we talked last week about being sent people, the urgency, the right now, because what we've got to understand is look at, accomplish His work. You see, you understand God is working. He's working right now. He's doing something. Even if you don't think things are ready, I remember this day. When I was a young adult pastor, I used to take the young adults down to this food kitchen downtown Vancouver, and we would go and we'd serve these people. They'd come in the room, we'd be prepping it all, we'd come out, we'd serve them, hang out with them. And this one day, the people who were running the food kitchen were like, we're not ready. And we're like, okay. And they're all, boom, they're sitting there, 40 people in the room ready to go. And they're like, yeah, just like do something. Like, do something? What do you mean do something? What, am I supposed to get up and do a bit? You know, I was like, hey, I just flew in from New York and boy, are my arms tired. All right, my kids love that one, by the way. What do you want me to do? So they got this old guitar sitting in the corner and I haven't played guitar in 10 years at this point, all right? So I pick this guitar up and I walk out on stage and everyone's just like sitting there. I'm like, hi, you know, I'm Mark. And I sit down and I'm like, well, I guess I'm going. So I don't say anything. I just start to pick this guitar. And I start to just sing. I don't know what I'm singing. I'm just like, I'm singing, man. I'm like, flowers are blooming, life is a go. Whatever, right? And all of a sudden I get in the zone. And I start to rive, you know, like when you're doing, you're an artist, like you're like, or you're working, or like you get in the zone and you can't sign. You're just like, okay, I'm in the suite. I'm in the, man. And I remember I just did 5 minutes of something. It was like I looking in at my own body or something. And it was like, and then it just ended. And the whole room was dead quiet. And it was like, you could hear a pin drop. And I was zoning out and I came back in. All these leaders that were, they were sitting there like, what was that? I'm like, I don't actually know what just happened. And they all started to applaud and they're like, more. And I'm like, no, you got to go out on top at that point, bro. You got to just walk out. I'm done. I just laid down some Bob Dylan, all right, genius. And like, there was like this spiritual moment where then I started to talk to these people about my testimony. I started to tell them as they're like, you know, keep going. We need more time with the food. So I started talking about my life. And what I realize is, man, God is working and doing stuff way outside your capacity and in your timing and the way that you would do it. Let me spend 8 weeks prepping the thing. No. He's going to show up because, guys, there's such thing as the supernatural. God is working, moving, still alive, still speaking, still moving, still saving. And the question is, can you hear him? Can you listen? Can you follow along? Because here's Jesus saying, my main thing is to do his work. To do his work. Here's what I love. Remember last week, look, I tell you, lift up your eyes. I love this. Some of you in this moment, you're blind to the fact that God is working and you need to lift up your eyes about some stuff. You need to start to see because you've been behind the veil a bit and you haven't seen that he's working and moving and doing things. And this is a good word for everybody, for you harder types. There's a thing about lifting up your eyes. Like, do you ever stop and just kind of go, man, there's something to God speaking to me through nature and oceans and mountains and trees and birds and the beautiful, like I'm a worker, I'm a competitor, I'm a capitalist, lift up your eyes a little bit. Open your eyes to the world around, learn a thing. And then to those of you who are nothing but feelers, lift up your eyes, like open your eyes a bit. Like maybe you need to think a little more about the fact that, you know, Christianity is not just this beautiful thing that makes you connect to the universe and nature. It's something that actually historically, logically, scientifically makes sense. You realize this whole like version of Christianity, that's this anti-science movement, that's like 200 years old. All through history, Christianity has been the science. Let's push science. Let's go. Lift up your eyes. What is it in your life today that you need to go? I need to humble myself and learn something that God is trying to teach me in this moment because I haven't been paying attention. I haven't stopped and been still and gone. I need to learn a thing right now. Like this week, my two older kids left the house and I was sitting in my house with my wife and my younger daughter was up in her room. And I just said, you know, what can we do with our time today? And Aaron's like, well, you know, you could do something with Bella. And I was like, yeah. And then all of a sudden I was like, I walked up to her room. I said, Bella, you want to go to the driving range? And she's like, boom. She looks, she's like, golfing? I'm like, yeah. She's like, yeah. She jumps up and we go out to the driving range and lunch. We hung out for a few hours and it was like connection. And in that moment, it took me to stop and lift up my, like, what is, what, how could I connect to her? What is this moment? So we're all learning everything about life all the time. But the question is, do you have a posture of learning? I'm going to learn something new about God, about salvation, about my life, about my family, about my money, about my marriage. Maybe this week's a week where you need to lift up your eyes a bit and stop kind of having your head down and kind of doing your thing. Now, what is it we're lifting up our eyes and learning about? What is it the thing that we're doing? Look at this. It's this. And this is what I want to talk about for a few minutes because it's a very popular conversation. Wipe that all away so I can focus in here. Look at this. To do the will of him who sent me. The will of God. What do we say about the will of God? Jesus' entire life was about doing the will of God versus the will of himself all the time. He listened to the voice of the Father and he was obedient to what the Father had sent him to do. Jesus is the only person, William Barclay says, in all the world who never did what he liked, but always what God liked. The question is, man, like we're supposed to be listening and following the will of God versus the will of family, the will of sin, the will of friends, the will of the world, the will of temptation, the will of the devil, even when it kicks against how we feel, because doing the will of God is how we find peace, happiness, and power in our life. But what do we mean by the will of God? Can we do a little teachable moment here? Because a very complex topic, and we've talked about this in past sermons. I remember 2 or 3 years ago, we unpacked some of these ideas, and I remember talking with people, and they just said this was super helpful because it's a very confusing topic to understand doing the will of God. And of course, Jesus is going, this is what I want to do. So we want to understand what it means. So let me come at this and just kind of tell you what I said a couple of years ago. A couple of theologians point out the fact that there's three kinds of the will of God that are talked about in the Bible. Okay, so the first is God's will of decree. So sometimes when we're talking about the will of God, we get confused because we're like, well, what's the will of God? I thought all things that happened in the world were the will of God. But then there's like the specific will. I don't understand what's going on. How does that work? Okay, so let me talk about this. So first is a will of decree. And the will of decree is that it's Ephesians 1 verse 11. All things that happen basically are the will of God, right? That's the concept. So everything that comes to pass is according to God's will. Everyone who passes away, it's according to God's timing. The death and resurrection of Jesus was the predestined, determined plan of God. That's why Revelation 13, it says, but long before the creation of the world, there was a book written before the foundation of the world. And the name of the book is the book of the people whose are saved because of the Lamb who was slain. That means the Lamb who was slain was in the mind of God before the foundation of the world happened. How is that even possible? Because the will of God is getting done in the world. Jesus is walking into Jerusalem, Hosanna, Hosanna. The Pharisees freak out and say, stop saying that. And Jesus says that if these people shut up, the rocks will cry out. Why? Because even if you don't do the will of God, it's getting done. That's the will of God's decree. He is going to move the hearts and kings, send the weather he wants. God is sovereignly in control, providentially in control of all things. And that's the will of God in that sense. Then there's the will of desire. God's will of desire. And that's when God sets commands down for us. And he says, I want you to love your neighbor. I want you to love your enemy. I want you to not lust. I want you to do this and this. So Matthew chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. So this is like, God wants us to do this, but the thing about that is that we don't always do God's will of desire, right? God's will of desire is that we don't sin, but we sin. We know we do. We disregard God's command to do this and not do that. Don't be idolatrous. You know, don't lie, don't murder. We do those things. And then thirdly, there is God's will of direction. And that's the one we talk about the most. Who am I going to marry? What city do I want? What is God calling me to live in? What school should I go to? And there's one of two things that we do with the question of God's will of direction. And it's like, we either under-spiritualize the question, which is we just live our life and we never stop and pray. And we never say, God, what do you want me to do? Should I marry this girl? What school should I go to? What city should I live in? We just never stop and do it. And the problem with that is that we can derail our life pretty quick if we never stop and ask the question, what are the scriptures? I mean, how often have I in my life felt like a kind of pressure in this job as a pastor and a leader? As one leader calls it, which I totally connected to, I remember listening to a guy preach one time and he called it Bread Truck Monday. Bread Truck Monday for a pastor is the Monday, which is every Monday, that after preaching and hanging out, you get up in the morning, you go, you know what? I'm just gonna go drive a bread truck for my life. And because bread doesn't cheat on their wife. They don't send nasty emails about production quality. They don't talk about volume in the church service. They don't mess around with Enneagram profiles as a staff member. He's just driving it, just dropping bread off. It smells nice, moving on with my life. That's the dream of a pastor some days. Now, what if I woke up and I said, you know what? That's what I'm gonna do. What's the reason that keeps me from going to drive a bread truck? Because then I'm reading the scriptures and they remind me why I do what I do. I'm praying and the voice of Jesus says, remember I called you into this thing. Someone sends an email or a text saying, thank you for, and I'm back on to God, I wanna do what you want me to accomplish in the world. And when we under-spiritualize trying to do the will of God, it's like, we're the center of the story and God's in the background and he's never being talked to about any decisions we're making in our life. Like, do you ever ask God whether you should invest in that company? Do you ever ask God whether you should, you know, invest in that stock? Do you ask God whether you, do you ever bring God into the granular stuff of your life? Or is he just in the backdrop? The image I like to give is like, remember watching the Flintstones? You know, Fred lived in like a 1,000-square-foot house, but he would run in his house for long periods of time, and somehow his house would just keep passing in the background, and it'd be like the same plant, same plant, same plant, same plant, and same chair, same rock, but they just keep in the background, because the animators are like, man, my priority is Fred. That's who I'm focused on. The background doesn't matter. Nobody cares. You just put it on repeat. That's how we live our life sometimes. God's opinion on this thing, it's in the backdrop. I'm running. I'm the main part of the story. I'm the center of the thing. Plant, 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 plant. Who cares about what his will is? And so we under-spiritualize it. We never ask the question. Where do you want me to work? What do you want me to do in this moment, in this moment, in this moment? Bringing him into the granular versus just the spiritual. And then sometimes we under-spiritualize, and then sometimes we over-spiritualize. And I've talked about this often, the idea that I don't know who I'm married until God shows me in the sky. You know, I'm thinking about two or three different girls that I could marry, because back in the day, you'd marry one of the 9 girls in your village that weren't your sister, but now there's so many options, right? There's a paralysis of choice, as sociologists call it. We don't know what to do. And so God, give us a sign, give us a sign. Let someone walk by and say the name of the girl. Let me look up and see the airplane chemtrails and let me go, oh my goodness, they look like an S. And I was thinking about marrying Sally. I think that's what it is. And so we over-spiritualize everything. We think God has a crystal ball that we look into and he's gonna give us some mystical message about everything. The job we're supposed to take, the city we're supposed to work in, the person we're supposed to marry. And sometimes that's just not what happens. We don't get to put a fleece out because one guy in the Bible put a fleece out and now we think that's what everyone's supposed to do with every decision they make in life. There's sometimes in the Bible something is descriptive, not prescriptive. It's just saying this happened that one time. Don't build a life on it. And the reason we do that is because we lack faith. Because we're a generation of entitlement that thinks God should tell us everything before we do it. And because we think we deserve a perfect life, ergo we're afraid to make a mistake and fumble and have a life that wouldn't have been as great as we envisioned, because fundamentally we do not view ourselves as pilgrims on a journey to heaven. We view ourselves as settlers who want heaven now. Thus, I can't make a bad decision. God's got to tell me everything up front. And in the Bible, it says that's not how this works. Ephesians 5 doesn't say, hey, Mark, I want you to marry, her name is Erin, it's in the Greek, go look it up on your Bible code app and figure it out. It's not what he says. He says, I want you to love and serve a woman like Christ loved and served the church, no matter what her name is. No matter what job you take, no matter what city you live in, this is how I want you to do that job and love that city. That's what the will of God is for our life. So sometimes we over-spiritualize things. I met with a couple a while ago. I was doing some counseling with them. They were dating and they were sleeping together. And I said, what are you doing? And they said, you know what? It's not the will of God that we wait until marriage. I said, whoa, okay. So you want to do the will of God? Yes, great. How do you know it's not the will of God? We talked about it and we feel it. Ah, you feel it. Here's what I think. I think you felt it. I think you had some bad pizza because you didn't get that interpretation from the Bible. That's a completely subjective experience, clearly filtered through a desire to do a certain thing, even though God's will is something different. And this is where we have to be very careful when we over-spiritualize things, because if we're not living our life according to what the scriptures lay out for us, objectively over our lives, and we're not being disciples of Jesus, coming under Jesus as subjects to a master, we're engaging it as equals, saying, I will take what I want and leave what I want. And Jesus just said, I'll tell you who the people are in Matthew 7 who get into heaven. They're not the people who said, Lord, Lord, and did what they wanted. They're the people who said, Lord, Lord, and did the will of the Father. That's the people who are actually people who are saved, members of the covenant, people going to the new, people who are experiencing the love and the glory and the delight and the pleasure of God forevermore. People who lived with the center question every day when they woke up and put their feet to the floor. What is the will of God in this particular scenario? And if he doesn't give me specifics, like some of you, you're afraid to move and do anything because you're still waiting for the specifics. Let me tell you something. The will of God is not confusing corn maze type stuff where you, sometimes we approach it like we're living in a choose your own adventure book. And if I go to page 40, remember those, when I grew up, I read choose your own adventure, it was these books where you'd like, you know, page 1, 2, 3, and then you can go into space or you can go dig a tunnel. Which one? And you're like, oh, I don't know. Because one of them always ended up, you know, you got on the spaceship and it blew up and you're like, ah, I should have just gone in the tunnel because the tunnel would have got me to the end of the story. We think the will of God's like that. Man, if I make this, oh my God, oh, you know, my life. No. The will of God is no matter what path you choose, you're to be conformed to the image of Christ. And sometimes he gives it to you specific and sometimes it's as generic as, look, I want you to be obedient. Don't murder. So there's people who are like, oh, well, I'm waiting for the voice of God to tell me not to get or to get baptized. Really? You've been a believer for 10 years? Oh yeah, I love Jesus. So get baptized. No, and I'm waiting for a specific voice of God to tell me. That's, no, it's just a command. Like, be baptized. You don't have to wait for a specific voice to tell you not to murder someone. It's like, don't murder people. It's not like, well, I know he said that, but you know, I didn't hear the specifics and see that in my alphageti, so I'm going to do it. That's to over-spiritualize the question. And so we get direction from God in specific scenarios. More often than not, what we get is the scriptures unpacking obedience and saying, live this way. And that's what it means to obey the will of God. So then, that this is Jesus' whole life. It's his whole work. This is what he wants to do. So then it says, verse 35, do you not say there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. We talked about that last week in the sense of the missional task. And then he says, already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life. This is what we want, fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. There's people doing the work and you might be working on someone that someone else is going to come along and see come to know Jesus. and you had a part to play. For here, the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. There's gonna be a win for everyone when we start to do the work of ministry and see people come to know Jesus and love and serve people in word and deed. People are going, there's going to be fruit that comes of it because it's God's work in the midst of it. In verse 39, many Samaritans from that town believed in him. Because of the woman's testimony, he told me all that I ever did. Verse 40, so when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, I love this, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe. They're like, you got us to a point, right? That's what those earlier verses, you did something, there's a laborer, there's a reaper, there's those who sows. Don't all say, oh, I can't believe I didn't see it. No, you do the work. And so they're saying, we're not doing it just because you, we've heard for ourselves. And we know, I love this because this is exactly what she wanted. Don't believe in Christianity because of me, believe in it because of Jesus. Don't believe in Christianity because of Village Church. Don't believe in Christianity because of Mark Clark. Oh yeah, don't. There is a principle I live by, which is this: those who we idolize, we will one day demonize. This is why when people go, oh, your sermon has changed my life. I talked about this a couple weeks ago. Oh yeah, there's just a time ticker on me going tick, 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 tick. There's only a matter of time till they go, I hate you. I can't believe you. I mean, everything about your life. It's like, don't believe because of people, because that's gonna make you walk away from the church. That's gonna make you walk away from Jesus because people are gonna fumble it and let it down. I see so many people today leaving because they're saying, you know, the church is full of racists. The church likes politics too much. The church burned witches. The church has done, I get that. The church view on sexuality is, I understand. The church is fill in the blank, and so I'm leaving it. Listen, there is a place for corrective thinking around the way that the church has functioned in the past. And there's a necessity for the church to at times rise up and give corrective. Look at Bonhoeffer living in World War II and the Nazis, and he's fighting Nazi ideology to say, we got to be faithful to the gospel. But here's what he doesn't do. And this is what I just hope doesn't happen in regard to the global scenario. He doesn't leave the church. He does what Paul does with Judaism. He gives what N.T. Wright calls a critique from within. He says, I'm not going to abandon the church because there has been racism and there has been oppression and there has been terrible things through history. I'm going to look at it and say, these were messed up institutional ways of Christianity and systems and people who didn't really understand what Jesus was calling them to. But I got to clear some of that off the table and look at Jesus himself and say, I'm going to judge Christianity based on Jesus and Jesus alone. And so this is what he's saying. Of course, if we base our faith on people, we're going to be let down. But it says, we've heard for ourselves now. We're asking the question for us now. Not from the hypocrites from the past, not from how people have fumbled and stumbled around this. At the end of the day, guys, you got to come before Jesus and go, do I have a relationship with you? Not what are leaders saying? What are people online saying? Have a relationship with Jesus myself. And we know that this is indeed, I love this, the Savior of the world. We need saving. This is why one of the great categories of Jesus is Savior. Savior from sin, Savior from ourselves, Savior from the wrath of God. He saves. And I think one of the things about our culture is we don't like the feeling that we need saving. We want to save ourselves. We want to better ourselves. We want to make things, we're going to solve everything by working harder and figuring it out through progress and technology and education. We're going to figure it out. And the fundamental, I remember a few years ago, when the Rapunzel movie came out, I remember Disney came out and said, this is kind of our last princess movie, Tangled, because we don't love the concept of a woman in a tower needing to be saved by a man, because every princess story is, of course, this woman needs to be rescued. And I understand that in regard to the gender critique, but I think there's even a humanist part of us that just doesn't like the concept of we need saving at all from anybody external. Pull up your moral bootstraps. You can do it. You write your own destiny. That's how self-help survives. That's how New Age exists. By making you believe that you can save yourself and you can be anything. And Christianity starts out and goes, I need you to believe something first, though. You're actually broken and lost and in need of saving. So we need a savior. That's why Martin Lloyd-Jones years ago said, if you don't believe yourself to be broken and a sinner, Christ will never look precious to you. Do you, watching this, recognize the need for the savior? Jesus, not only as Lord, not only as a good teacher. And I know it's hard because we don't feel like we need saving. Saving from what? Things are good. This is what Neil Postman called the problem of pleasure. He said, if you look back to cultures throughout time and you try to hone in on American cities to represent those moments, he said, you could almost say back in the day, Boston could represent the great priority of 17, 1800s with politics, the establishing of politics. New York, later on, maybe at the turn of the century, with immigration and capitalism. And he said, but if you were to try to come up with a city that represents this cultural moment, what would it be? And he said, it would be Las Vegas. We are a people that are entertaining ourselves to death into complete apathy. We don't even ask the question anymore because we don't want to sit long enough with the kickback. But if we can just keep entertaining ourselves, if the new Netflix show, that 10 seconds is killing me in between the shows because I'm going to have to sit here and have an existential crisis about my identity and who I am and my origins and what's the problem of evil. Oh, good. The next episode started. Deet, 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 yeah. And we're on. And friends can distract me. It's funny when people look at certain shows and they're like, I want to make sure my teenager doesn't watch that show. You know, it's got blood and gore. And then they let them watch Friends. No, I'm not banking on Friends here. But Friends potentially could be just as harmful because it creates a construct of how do you think about sex? How do you think about money? How do you think? And it dulls our expectations. This is the problem of pleasure and entertainment, that it lets us sit in the malaise until we've stopped asking the question of whether I need saving at all. And Christianity breaks in and makes it all uncomfortable, goes, we all do. Savior of the world, everybody, including you. And I know you're doing great. And I know you're the exception to the rule, but you ain't. So Lord, I do pray in this moment that we would understand what the great hymn writer, the guy who wrote Amazing Grace, John Newton, said at the end of his life. My memory is nearly gone, he said, but I remember two things, that I am a great sinner and that Christ is a great savior. I pray in this moment those two things would define the life of everyone watching this, listening to this, everyone who's part of this awesome church, wondering why week in and week out, we come back to this reality. It's because you kept doing it in your ministry. And the gospel kept bringing us back to it. John keeps telling us about it. Any book that we're in just keeps bringing us back to it because we need reminding, because we're so quick to forget. Save people right now. You are the savior. I ask and pray that you would save people right now. That they would repent of sin and realize they need a Savior, that you died on a cross for that sin, that you rose again to give them life, eternal life, and that they need to trust in you versus themselves. And in that moment, you save them. And angels rejoice in heaven when one sinner repents, you said in one of your parables. Please do that among us. We trust that you will. And let those of us who know you cherish you better today because of this text, because of what you're doing in our life, and let our eyes be lifted up to actually see what you're doing, and so we're not blind to it, so we can see it and love it and move in it. In Jesus' great name we pray, amen.